Greetings, fellow humans, and welcome to the book Wormhole. I had a really productive month, both reading and writing-wise. As I mentioned last month, I participated in a modified version of NaNoWriMo, where pretty much I wanted to finish editing my book last month. I ended up meeting my goal, which I am really happy about, and I hope everyone else who participated in NaNoWriMo had a positive experience with it as well, even if you didn't end up meeting your goal. So let's dive into this month's reads. Atomic Accidents by James Mahaffey. I really want to start incorporating more nonfiction books into my monthly reading, since all the nonfic I've read this year up until this point I really enjoyed. I was really excited to start this one, especially after reading Before the Fallout last month. It felt like a logical next subject to read about after that one. However, I only got 25 pages in, and I didn't make it past the second introduction. Yes, it has two introductions. The first one talks about a major accident at the world's largest hydro plant, and I understand why Mahaffey brings this up, because I think nuclear plants already have a bad rep of being dangerous. The point of talking about other forms of energy and their lethality is to say that all technology comes with risk. I thought it was a little weird that the book starts with this point rather than using it as a conclusion. Then we get to the second introduction, which is also not about nuclear plants either. This one was about steam train accidents. This is a topic that sounds near to the author, being that he witnessed one as a small child, but essentially says the same thing as the first introduction about technology and its dangers, and it dwells on it longer than necessary. This section wanders off into the history of people actually profiting off of hosting shows where audience members pay to watch two steam engines collide head-on, sometimes resulting in fatalities, if not injury alone. Which maybe he wanted to say that humanity has a habit of finding disaster to be entertaining, which is a fair point. But again, he spends so long on it. I never actually started reading the book. Just the two intros kind of turned me off to the book. It left me with the impression that the narration was going to be very unfocused and meandering. So I DNF'd this book. I don't know if I'll go back to it. It's a topic I do want to read about. I just don't think this author's style fits my preferences. How to Mars by David Ebenbach. This is a near future science fiction. Our main characters are the cast of a reality TV show called Destination Mars, which follows the daily lives of six scientists living on Mars. At the start of the book, the show has been canceled, but the scientists remain behind as the contract was for a one-way trip to Mars. However, things are about to be shaken up when one of the scientists discovers, despite all protocol, that she is pregnant. Okay, so I was instantly interested in this concept. I don't really watch reality TV, but this book promised to be a pretty funny light read, or at least what I got from the synopsis. I feel a bit misled. First off, I had a hard time believing this would be a reality TV show. Reality TV is notorious for being fake, and I was really hoping the story would lean into that. This book, however, is painfully honest with a complete lack of drama and focuses on scientific discovery. Like, reading it, I understood why this show got canceled, because who wants to watch people be bored? Even during the vetting process, all of the tests revolve around boring menial work, so obviously the people in charge knew it would be boring. I don't know how something that is so obviously very expensive without much chance of success would ever be created in the first place. I think it would have made a more convincing slice of life documentary, and that would have better fit the tone of the book. And not much happens in this book. Everything is told through monologue-like segments from various characters' POVs. I definitely saw potential there in the plot, but any created tension is very quickly dispersed. For one, when Jenny first informs the production that she is pregnant, she is told she needs to have an abortion because a pregnancy on Mars would no doubt have too many complications that could lead to fetal death, death of the mother, or even both, a point which is routinely stated throughout the book. However, when Jenny consults the doctors on board, they point out that performing an abortion would be equally as risky. I wish we got to see a little more into Jenny's headspace. This part of the book is told from Josh, the baby daddy's POV, and nothing about it relates exactly how Jenny feels about this pregnancy. If she wants to keep it, if she's upset about the order to abort, she has a choice to make which risk she wants to take, but we are never shown the scene where she decides, and it leaves the story feeling like she wasn't given a choice at all. There's a lot of interesting points that could have been explored but aren't, leaving the story feeling ultimately unfulfilling. There's also dangers such as losing power on the facility. Again, the childbirth in space could be problematic, as well as one of the antisocial scientists considers killing everyone by sabotaging life-sustaining equipment. And none of these things actually pose a threat in this story. They're just kind of mentioned to be a threat but are never shown. Like, I would have liked to have seen a brief power outage on the facility and everyone scrambling to fix it. Or maybe something weird happens in the pregnancy and Jenny worries about it. But no, the book is mostly just like in the narrative saying, ah, yes, this is a potential danger we live with, but nothing ever actually happens. And there's a really mute point that annoyed me with this book, and that's the way sex is talked about. When the scientists signed on for the show, they were given one big rule they can't break, and that is they can never have sex for the rest of their lives since this is a one-way trip. This abstinence-only rule just launched me back in time to high school sex ed. It just felt so immature to expect six adults to never engage in sex for the rest of their lives, and I know for some people that isn't an issue, but it's just a really bizarre rule to me, especially considering the emphasis on how boring it is to live on Mars. Like, humans are gonna experiment. It's also annoying how apparently they have pregnancy tests on the facility, but no contraception. Like, how hard would it be to throw some rubbers on the supplies sent out every few months just to be extra cautious? It's also really heteronormative to assume that the only sex that will be happening is sex between men and women, which could lead to pregnancy. Eppenbach only lends like one line to this point before ignoring it entirely, which wasn't enough for me. But also kind of ages too. Like, I get that Destination Mars probably wanted to get the most bang for their buck by sending young people who will live a long time, but eventually the ladies are gonna go through menopause and won't be able to get pregnant. But apparently they still aren't allowed to have sex for some trivial reason. But another plot relating to this and contraception is that all scientists were expected to get their tubes tied before dispatching. Except Jenny gets exempt because she was allegedly unable to have children. I phrase that specifically that way because that does not mean that she is sterile. From what I gather about Jenny's situation, it sounds like her uterus is irregularly shaped, something I actually got misdiagnosed with at one point in my life, and this makes it a lot harder for a fertilized egg to implant in the uterus, resulting in a pregnancy. But it doesn't mean that there's absolutely no chance of pregnancy. It just means it's a lot harder to get pregnant. And what annoyed me about this plot and knowing that information is that the doctors looked at her bits and decided that she didn't need to get her tubes tied because apparently she was already covered, when that is not the case. And it's just, I don't know who is in charge of that, but that is a mistake and that shouldn't have been made. But it had to happen for this story to happen. And it is true that tubes tied, while very effective, can sometimes fail. So honestly, I believe Josh could have fathered a child. I just think Jenny's backstory of infertility was highly unrealistic. Like, honestly, instead it could have been like, well, only the guys need to get surgery. Because if I remember correctly, I think it's a lot less invasive of a procedure on men than women, and honestly, that's probably enough protection to minimize the chances of pregnancy, but still keep the odds high enough to have allowed this plot without containing a plot device that is poor medical advisory. I also found it kind of dumb how the folks at Destination Mars were angry at Josh and Jenny for the pregnancy throughout the rest of the book, yet it is because of that the show finally gets put back on air. Like, you think they'd be happier about having drama to actually show? Again, it just doesn't make a convincing reality TV show the way it's executed. interspersed with the plot are chapters that are segments from Destination Mars Manual for Life on Mars. The first of which, titled What You Can't Bring With You, was actually a short story. And as a separate short story, I actually really like it. But I don't think it deserved expanding upon, and none of the other sections of the manual hit as well as the original. Ultimately, the book mostly explores the psychology of leaving a planet behind and living in seclusion amongst a small group of people in space, which it's common enough in sci-fi stories that this book fails to stand out to me. How to Mars earned a 3-star rating for me. The story is not what I expected. I think this book needs to be marketed differently. I honestly don't think it's terrible, but it didn't impress me. Okay, so the next four books I read were all part of the Binti trilogy, so I'm going to talk about them mostly all together since what I liked about them carries over from book to book. Binti is an African futurist science fiction novella series. After Binti secures a full scholarship to the prestigious intergalactic university, Umza Uni, she makes the decision to leave Earth behind, as well as her family and her people, the Himba tribe, who culturally never leave their land. On her way to the university, the ship is boarded by the Meduse, a jellyfish-like alien who has a long history of war with the Himba's neighbors, the Kosh. After the Meduse slaughters everyone aboard, Binti is saved by a mysterious object called an Eden that she has carried with her since she once found it in the desert years ago. She also discovers that her, and I tried to look up how this word is pronounced and I couldn't find it. Ochi is my attempt. A substance her people make out of clay that the women wear on their hair and bodies, has healing properties to the Meduse. She befriends one of the younger Meduse named Okwu, through which she learns that the Meduse are on their way to Umza Uni to retrieve a stinger stolen from their chief that is now on display at the university. As a master harmonizer, Binti works as a peacemaker between the Meduse and the many aliens at Umza Uni, attempting to de-escalate the situation without prompting war to break out. I love the incorporation of the real culture of the Himba tribe in this book. I like how much of that culture still exists while also the Himba have technology existing alongside it. And I like the constant presence of the Ochi in this book, which is an actual thing that the Himba tribe women use to keep clean. I like the role of tradition in this book and how it presents unique challenges to Binti. And I really like the instances of racism that Binti is presented with, such as people touching her hair without permission or saying that she looks like she's covered with feces when it is just her Ochi. I think the ignorance is really authentically relayed in this book in the way that offers understanding to what it feels like to be an outsider. I love the biotech in this book. The fact that so much technology is a living thing makes me so happy. I love that ships are actually genetically engineered living shrimps. That is so incredibly cool to me. Also, all of the aliens in this book, there are so many once she reaches Umza Uni, and very few are given names as to their species, but rather just described. It's a really neat way that relays just how many species of aliens exist at the university while not being info dumpy. I could really picture this wonderfully large, prestigious, and diverse university planet that Akor 4 created, whereas in other works where humans are meant to be the minority, I don't always get that sense. Afterwards, she studies at Umza Uni as one of the few humans on the planet and the only Himba. In Binti's Sacred Fire, which is Binti 1.5, something that came out, I think, after the series was finished to bridge the gap between the first and second books, we see a little more of Binti's time spent at university studying her Eden with her new mentor, making friends while also mostly feeling out of place at the university. But a lot of what happens in this book is referenced in passing in Binti Home, so I don't think this book is like, you need to read this to understand the full series. It mostly just supplements. What I did like in this book particular is the aftermath of what Binti went through on her way to the university. As much as she values Okwu as a friend, there's times where she's left questioning if it had a part in the killing of everyone aboard the ship. She also experiences moments of PTSD, which carries on throughout the rest of the series. And one painful part in particular is when she has a phone call with the family of one of her friends that died on the ship, and they are just awful to her and blaming her for surviving when their son and brother had died. It was painful to read, but it also felt incredibly realistic. In Binti home, she decides she needs to return home to complete her pilgrimage, a rite of female adulthood that she hadn't before she left a year ago to attend university. Okwu accompanies her as an ambassador, though the Kosh are less than welcoming to its presence on Earth. Not to mention, tensions rise in Binti's family, as her leaving was a taboo in her culture. The night before her pilgrimage, she sees the Night Masquerade, a figure that symbolizes change and traditionally can only be seen by men. Shortly after, a group of desert people come to collect Binti, and she is forced to depart with them. I honestly didn't like the abrupt ending to this one. While I love when a story that is meant to have a sequel ends on momentum that tells me what the next book is going to be about, it felt like Home didn't have its own plot arc to justify it existing as its own book. I think Home and Night Masquerade, the third and final book in the Binti series, should have been combined into one longer book. Night Masquerade picks up where Home leaves off, with Binti being led into the desert to meet the desert people's leader. While she knew her father was born of the desert people, she finally meets her grandmother and is enlightened to the true culture of the desert people, who call themselves the Enyi Zenaria. She is indoctrinated shortly before she senses a disturbance back at home. Binti rushes home, only to discover war is brewing once again between the Meduse and the Kosh, with her village directly in the crossfire, and Binti must once again use her talents as a harmonizer to diffuse tensions before her people are destroyed. I love the conflict in this one. It's such a natural response to everything that has happened into the series up until this point, and it really feels like the plot is finally coming to a head. Not to mention, I felt like it perfectly captures war and conflict that is already happening in our time. I found it interesting how Binti's learned biases about the Enyi Zenaria or the desert people are called out in this book, especially given that Binti is black and routinely faces ignorance from other people. It's kind of refreshing to see that she is also susceptible to learned biases, while also reinforcing this general theme in the book of traditional culture does not mean that they are backwards, they just have different norms. And there's another cool piece of biotech from these people that involves microbes in the bloodstream, which allows them to communicate with each other from distances away. Like, way cooler than a cell phone, hands down. At the end, Binti does learn what purpose her Eden was created for, and it was surprisingly underwhelming despite being one of the driving mysteries of the overall series. Like, even in narrative, Binti says she's underwhelmed. Overall, I think the Binti series is amazing and really awakened that part of me that loves the idea of living among aliens. Binti, I rated a strong 5 stars. I'm debating on my ratings for the other books. I originally gave them 4 stars on Goodreads, but only because compared to the first book, it didn't feel like they were as concise and solid. Again, I think 2 and 3 should have been combined, and Sacred Fire doesn't offer much as a standalone either, and probably could have been absorbed into a larger book as well. Still, I thoroughly enjoyed these books, and if Okoro forever writes more in the Binti storyline, which I think there is so much more room to explore in the universe she created, I will be so thrilled to read more of it. Sienna by Gideon Marcus. This is a young adult space opera series and the second book in the series. Keitra takes on her first client, the Royal Sienna, who is in search of a new habitable planet for her people. However, viable planets are few and far in between, and many others have their sights on new land. Just when Keitra thinks they found the perfect planet, they discover a ghost ship in orbit, and suddenly thousands of lives are at stake. this is a very rare instance where I like the second book more than the first book, with series that never happens with me. But whereas the first book, Keetra, does a good job of establishing the characters and the world, it almost feels very standalone. Like, oddly enough, Keetra feels more like a prequel than a first book, giving generous background to these characters and establishing how the crew came together and how they got their ship, but not entirely vital information to understanding the series as a whole. Whereas with Sienna, I finally see how this will be a series and what to expect from the books to come. The stakes are raised in this book, the way it ends is different from Keetra in a way I prefer and leaves the story with momentum to be picked up in the third book. I continue to love the crew in this series. This book hones in on a few specific crew members where others end up in the background, but I imagine with each book in the series, different characters will shine. I love learning more about Pinky's past with Keetra, especially since the first book briefly mentioned they were childhood friends, and Pinky as a character I just endlessly hunger for more information about, being that he is the only alien we've met so far in the series, and it's clear that in this world, aliens are rare. I also low-key ship Pinky and Fareed, and there was a part in this book where I was like, wait, does the author ship this too? Will we see more development between Pinky and Fareed in the books to come? Romance exists among the crew, but it never comes in the way of friendship or functionality. Thank God. I have a hard time with young adult books when romance drama is a central plot, especially when there are so many other important things going on. I like that science has a presence in this book without being overwhelming, neither coming off as info dumping, nor being inaccessible to readers who don't have a background in science. I can imagine this series potentially inspiring teens to go into science because those added details spark some interest. I also love the illustrations in this book. This one's my favorite one in the book, and that is Pinky in the spacesuit. Look how cute he is. More books should be illustrated, I'm just saying. I rated this one 5 stars. It really cemented my love for the Keetra series, as well as leaves me eager to read the next book, Enclave by Anne Aguirre. This is a young adult post-apocalypse novel and the first in the Razorland trilogy. Deuce has survived to age 15, which means she finally gets a name and begins her work as huntress for the Enclave, a community that lives in the underground of a destroyed city. She is paired up with Fade, a somewhat mistrusted boy who originates from outside the Enclave. Rules are strict within the Enclave, and when one of Deuce's friends is pinned for a crime he didn't commit, Deuce takes the fall for him and gets banished to the world above. Fate's loyalty causes him to follow Deuce and assist in helping her survive in a world entirely different from the one she knew, ridden with flesh-hungry freaks and cruel gangs. As I mentioned in my library sale book haul video, I first heard of this book from a video game book recommendation list, and one of my concerns was it wasn't going to be similar to the game it was recommended off of, because another of the books I read from that list wasn't. It was just like, okay, I guess they're both sci-fi. Fortunately, this one actually did remind me of the game it was recommended from, which was Fallout. Both stories take place long after the apocalypse and explore post-society cultures with dynamics different from ours and focus on survival. Both have zombie-like monsters that were once human. It's a genre I don't often read, but I actually really like. However, I can't say this book is a shining example of the genre. The world feels underdeveloped. For one, the book lacks visceral detail and leaves a lot to the reader's imagination. And what I mean by that is, routinely there are details that are just so vague, they could have been better qualified by a single descriptor here or there. Things like a character's clothes, or a bag, or a sign could have better painted a mental image by determining if these things are handmade, pieced together from existing materials, or even entirely intact from the world before. And too often things are underdescribed in ways that I understand that I understand that the author is trying to relay that these things have no relevance to the current way of life, so they no longer have names, but they're clearly old world items that exist in our world, and yet not enough information is given for me to be able to identify what these things are. For example, metal shelter is often used, and I'm not sure if that's meant to be a car or what, because no more information is given. It's details like those I really value in the genre, because what I like about post-apocalypse is seeing the hermit crab ways surviving humans adapt a new home out of ruins. The culture of the enclave doesn't make sense. Occupations are split into three categories: builders, hunters, and breeders, but there are so many things and roles a civilization needs to function that isn't covered in those three categories. Like, we know that there is a healer in the enclave, but what role does that fall under? I don't like the name and ceremony. No one has a name until they reach age 15, which kind of makes sense considering a high mortality rate, but I found the ceremony of cutting the new adults and naming them after whatever object their blood lands on to be kind of dumb. First off, what's stopping the blood from landing on more than one object? Second off, there's this constant importance in the book to stay clean and that a single wound can become infected and kill you. So why are they intentionally cutting someone who survived long enough to become a contributing member of the enclave when they could die from this very wound? It just seems like it was trying to be edgy, and that's the only reason it exists. My other beef with this is that after the name and ceremony, people of the enclave officially age from being a brat to being an adult, and takes on one of three roles in the society. The book also emphasizes that the enclave has a short lifespan of 25 years, so 15 feels pretty late in life to expect people to contribute. Like, maybe there are smaller tasks in each three roles that under 15-year-olds could do to prepare for when they finally reach adulthood. It's just something never explored. Also, Deuce, like all members of the enclave, was raised by the collective breeders of the enclave rather than her birth mother, yet shows envy later on when Fade talks about his close relationship with his dad. Like, that doesn't make sense to me given her cultural background that she would feel like she's missing out. Or when later she has to trade an object that belonged to her birth mother, and the moment didn't have the potency it wanted because, first off, this object didn't exist in reader's mind until the very moment she pulls it from her pocket and explains its significance. And secondly, literally what I just said before, that there's no reason why she should have this connection to her birth mother when everyone she grew up around was raised the exact same way she was, and that was her norm. Then there's the matter of the main conflict, which is that the underground is overrun with these humanoid, flesh-eaten monsters called the Freaks. Part of a hunter's job is killing them to keep them away from the enclave. While it's obvious the Freaks were once human, it's never detailed how they became Freaks. I wish there was a scene of someone in the enclave starting to turn into a Freak and being banished for the safety of the enclave. Or even the book states that there's the threat of Freaks storming the enclave, but that never actually happens in the book, which, as I mentioned with How to Mars, threats like that I don't like to be told about. I want to be shown. At one point, Deuce and Fade are sent on a recon mission to another enclave because the leaders have suspicion that the Freaks are evolving to become smarter. During this mission, Deuce and Fade determine that this is indeed true, and the enclave they visit is entirely dead and overrun by Freaks. Then they return and tell the leaders what they've learned, and the news is entirely brushed aside and denied to be true. They literally send them there in the first place because they have suspicion, and then they come back and they're like, yeah, your suspicions were true, and the leaders are like, oh yeah, never mind, that can't be real. How does that make sense? How? They meet another group of people called the Burrowers, I think, or maybe it's the Tunnelers, I'm pretty sure it's the Burrowers, and while they are described as looking human but different, I think they were like shorter than average and ghostly pale, if I remember. It's never explained why these people look different or what sets them apart from the people living in the enclave, which also makes me wonder why doesn't the people of the enclave look different too, considering that they never seen the sun. And while there are no scenes of rape, it is something that exists in this book's world, which I don't love how it's handled. First of all sex in the book is called breeding regardless of consent, despite that there are clear situations where there hasn't been consent. I think the word desensitizes what is actually going on, even though as a reader I understood when there wasn't consent. This is one of those things that I see a lot in the specific subgenre of sci-fi, but it doesn't need to exist. Like, this is a choice on the author's part to put it in, and with this book specifically, all characters are like 15, give or take a few years, and it just seems like an awfully mature situation to be putting children in, especially since all instances of breeding in this book is specifically to procreate, not just for pleasure. Like, I can't imagine a 15-year-old even in a post-apoc world would be concerned about making sure children are born to maintain population. It's just weird to me, considering that this is a book aimed towards teenagers. But again, there aren't any scenes depicting it, it's just a topic that exists in the book. So readers beware. Lastly, because it is a young adult, of course it has to have a pointless love triangle. I rated this one 3 stars, another book which failed to impress me. I honestly don't know if I want to read on in this series. There's not much holding my interest with only one open-ended plot left at the conclusion of the book, and it's not enough to get me to read on at this point. I feel like I will forget about this series entirely next year. However, it did get me interested in finding more post-apocalypse books to read since it reminded me of how much I like the genre when it's done right. So if you have any post-apoc recommendations, please leave them in the comments below. Preferably no zombies though, it's not a favorite of mine. I don't have much determined for my TBR next month. Currently, this month, as I am filming this late, I'm trying to give myself a break and go with the flow, but I do have 2 buddy reads planned for December. The first is The Space Between Worlds by Makaya Johnson, which I am reading with Joan from The Rabbit Hole. I'm glad we're reading this because this was the book I mentioned in my mid-year freakout that I really wanted to read before the year ends, and now I am. And the other is The Fifth Wave by Rick Yancey, which I will be reading with Tiffany from The Masquerade Chick. Thanks for watching this video. Remember to support your local library and support independent bookstores when you can. Until next time, please stay tuned.